Bob, what's your date of birth?
February 16th, 27.
Well, where did you go to school, Bob?
Silver Creek High School. Graduated from there in 1944.
Yesterday, December 7th, 1941, a date which will live in infamy. The United States of America was suddenly and deliberately attacked by naval and air forces of the Empire of Japan.
There's a group of us young kids used to go across a footbridge into a ball field that was close to our home. And we were on our way over there to play football. My father came to the back door and hollered, "Bob, come on back." And I came back to the house. He had the radio on. It was all, of course, Japan bombing Pearl Harbor. And I do remember that very well. It was a very patriotic war, as you know. Mm-hmm. And a lot of us wanted to enlist right away. And some of us did. The VFW post in Silver Creek is named the Samuel Cimino post, and that was, Chief was his nickname, Chief Cimino. And he was the first one in my age group that enlisted and was killed, I think, in the South Pacific. But there was more of it. A young man by the name of Louis McGowan was a good friend of mine. He enlisted in the Marines, and he was blown up when he stepped on a landmine in Iwo Jima. So, but we all immediately felt that it was our thing to do and we should go. I enlisted in spring of 44 in the Air Corps, and I was accepted, and they were looking for pilots. And I was sent to college in Clemson, South Carolina. Not a great football school, as you know. And I went down there for a year, and May of that year, when we finished our first year, they told us that the war was winding down and there was no need for all the pilots. And we were all given 5 days to decide to either join another branch of the service, go into the ground crew, gunnery school, or the infantry. And all of us were so damn mad that we decided to go into another branch of the service. And I enlisted in the Navy. And we were called Air Corps Enlisted Reserves, ACERs. That was our nicknames. But I had a wonderful time. We marched to breakfast and, you know, got up in the morning to Reveille and went to bed to Taps, and it was all Army stuff.
So while you were in the Army Air Corps and Prince, you were at Clemson, what were they training you to do? What part of this?
It's funny, it was nothing particular for the Air Force. It was just to get the education. We had particular math classes that were very unusual, but they were easy in a sense that they were probably designed specifically to help us in the areas that they felt we would need. Mm-hmm. And I did fairly well and enjoyed it very much. I joined the Clemson Tigers dance band, and we used to go around and girls' schools down there and the smaller schools and play the weekends.
That was tough duty.
Yeah. It's funny because when I was in the Navy, is it Shirley?
Yeah.
Yeah. When I was in the Navy on board ship, I met a guy who was in Stan Kenton's band, played French horn in Kenton's band, and also was a guitar player. And I met a black kid from Philadelphia who was a bass player. And I met a young Jewish kid from Connecticut who was a wonderful piano player. And I can't remember the drummer, where he was from. Maybe Connecticut too, I don't know. But we got the chaplain and told him we were like to form a band. So he got us instruments the next time we came back to the States. And we formed this band, and when the other guys were chipping bulkheads, we were out practicing. And you know, mentioning the black kid that paid bass, you know, it was terrible in those days. The blacks on board ship had their own section. Mm-hmm. They couldn't go on any other sections of the ship. And they were the ones that waited on the chiefs and the officers in the mess hall. Mm-hmm. They had their own separate mess hall for the officers and the chiefs. And the only way we got this kid from Philadelphia out of there was to come and rehearse with us. And then every Sunday afternoon we'd play some tunes on board on the top on the ship, and maybe for an hour or so. And they'd sing or whatever.
Do you have a name for this band?
No. No. Assigned to a troop transport. Mm-hmm. And we carried occupation troops to Japan, and then went down into the Philippines and picked up troops that were had been there a while and brought them back. Yeah, it was a General W.C. Langfitt, L-A-N-G-F-I-T-T.
L-A-N-G.
G, mm-hmm. F-I-T-T.
Langfitt, okay.
General W.C. Langfitt. I was just a deck ape, they call him.
Yep.
I was a beginner. Do painting, and I worked in the kitchen. We had the soldiers did all of the serving and all that stuff, but there'd be one of us be kind of like a, not a foreman, but just kind of walk up and down the line making sure things went well.
Did you have a chance to talk to the troops at all?
Absolutely. In fact, I loved that. I can remember talking to a young man who was from Detroit. And he'd been in the Philippines for 3 years. And he said the only thing in life he wanted was to buy a Ford car and own a bar in Detroit, own a small bar. And you'd hear stories from all of these guys. They gambled a lot, by the way, too. They'd get up on the deck in the nice weather and spread out a blanket and literally pick up a knife and set it down next to them and then get their money out. Poker.
Poker.
Oh, yeah. You know, the Adderall that they had for the malaria, they would dye their t-shirts in that. Hmm. And they used to cut those boots up and make sandals out of them. And you'd see a guy walking down towards you in shorts, he'd cut his pants off into shorts, and a bright yellow shirt and sandals. So you knew where he'd been for a while. We carried about 40 Marines. And they were, you know, part of the ship's crew who patrolled the ship to make sure everything, you know, was done as it should be. And we carried 5,000 troops.
Oh my gosh.
Yeah, big ship. And we went to Osaka, and we went to one of the places that had been hit by the atom bomb. And we were allowed 2.5 hours ashore, that's all. I met a Japanese person who had a sword of his son's, who was an officer, and I bought him from him for $2 American.
Oh my gosh.
And I was a 19-year-old, well, he's still 18, and I came back on the ship, and the officer of the deck, the one who meets you at the top, said, "Where are you going with that sailor?" I said, "I hope to send it home someday." And he said, "No." He said, "You can't do that." He said, "I'll take it from you. I'll take care of it." And I'm sure it's hanging on somebody's wall today with a story behind it. I only had two really, what I would say, scary experiences. That was one of them in Nagasaki. when we start, we used to, it was so hot, we would take our fart sacks, as we called them, up on board and sleep on top. And going into Nagasaki at night in the dark, all of a sudden it just lit up in signals. And a buddy of mine was a corpsman, or a, not a corpsman, but a guy who could read signals. And he said, they're saying, get the hell out. You're sailing into an unswept minefield.
Oh my gosh.
And for about an hour, we were all on pins and needles. And the poor junior officer who was in charge of the ship at the time, the captain, I guess, really went up one side and down the other, and he assigned him to his room, which was all you could do. In other words, when he wasn't on duty, he had to stay in his quarters. And then later on that night, when we got out, we were supposed to do a big square, you know, and stay. And he got us miles and miles away from where we should have been. And he really showed how poorly he could run the ship, and the skipper made him pay, and should have. In the Philippines, we docked in Manila, where Manila, and we went ashore, and we were allowed to stay ashore at about 10 o'clock at night. And I can remember going to the famous hotel in Manila, which in those days was big, and there was a band playing in there, and believe it or not, it was a band that was doing all the Glenn Miller stuff. And I can remember standing outside listening to that music. We got to Leyte, a skipper went ashore, and then came back and got, we used to carry ice cream, because it would take us less than a month to get out and back. Carry lots of ice cream, and we used to trade ice cream in the islands for, and we traded ice cream off of Leyte for a Jeep. And then when we were coming back, of course, we painted it gray and put the numbers of the ship on, and the canvas maker made a top for it beautiful. And the minute that the ship landed, they just took one of the cranes and picked the Jeep up and put it on the shore, and that was the mail car that we used.
So you traded ice cream for a Jeep?
Yep. We one time hit a storm, and we were taking water, not a lot, but we were taking water. And the deck apes, like I said, I was, worked manned hand pumps to pump the water out. And we weren't scared. We weren't smart enough to be scared. And we were, you know, so young, we had faith in everything. We weren't worried a bit. Word was through the ship that we were going to hit it, and they had out lifelines, a big rope lifelines, and whenever you went out on deck, you had to get a hold of one of those and follow it. And the ship was, you know, like you see in the movies, it was going up and down just like that. Yep. Boy, it would hit, and everything would come right over the top. And I didn't know enough to be scared. I just knew I had to obey the orders, which were man the damn pump. So I did,
By the way, did you get seasick?
Oh, terrible. I sailed from Seattle on a Thursday night, and I didn't have anything to eat or couldn't keep anything down in my stomach until Sunday night. And all I'd take even crackers, dry crackers, and I'd throw them up.
Repeating this bulletin, dated San Francisco, the Federal Communication Commission quotes Domai saying, Japan accepts Allied terms.
I remember it. I was home then in Silver Creek. And I remember the kids riding around in the cars and blowing the horns, you know, the young kids, high school kids, riding on the running boards. We remember running boards.
Yeah, yeah.
And waving and everything. There's one. It's a big ocean, but every once in a while we would sight a mine that had broken away from their string of mines. And I was a what they call a hot shell man on a 5-inch 38 cannon. And a hot shell man was somebody who stood behind the gun, and when it was fired, the shells would come out. and you wouldn't catch him, but you'd guide him to one side of the pit or the other. And we had a young, not a young, but a, actually an old, but he was a short officer who was a gunnery officer. And he used to give the guys hell because they were, they'd sight it and call it off and they were lousy. I mean, they'd miss those mines.
These are floating mines.
Floating mines, yeah. Maybe, I don't know how many thousand yards away. And one time he was so pissed, he was so upset. He literally got up and sat on the barrel and sighted it and called all the numbers back to the gunnery crew and then climbed off and they fired it and they blew that mine out. And it's a mine that they, with all the equipment, you know, they couldn't do it right and he did it by sight. That's probably the funniest thing I do remember.
So who was your hero saxophone player that you listened to on the radio and tried to emulate?
Well, there were a lot of them, really. There's one that was with Duke Ellington, Johnny Hodges.
Johnny Hodges.
Played alto like I did. He didn't play like I did, he played it like he did, like I wished I could. And he was probably the best that I knew. We had so many days eligible as a veteran for money, you know, peanuts, a few bucks a week or a month. And at the college here, they built what they called the barracks, which was veterans housing. That whole front lawn was all barracks, and all the married veterans lived there. But I worked in the barracks. To build the barracks, and I can remember this clear as day. Shoveling a ditch was the foundation was gonna go in, and I remember kids walking by me on the sidewalk, conducting, and I used to tell Shirley, I can't get over those music students, conducting as they're walking, and 2 years later I was doing the same damn thing. I worked there for about 6 months. And then I decided to go to college. And music being my background or thing that interested me the most, I started out majoring in piano and then switched to saxophone. And I was the first college saxophone major east of the Mississippi, period.
Okay.
And my teacher, in fact, was very proud of that, Bill Willett.
So what's the question that people ask you about World War II that I haven't asked you, Bob?
Did I take any pictures? No, I didn't know enough to find a camera or take a camera. Did I see any action? No. It should mean a lot more than it did. And I don't know whose fault it is or where it fell apart, but you know, it was supposedly the war to end all, but it just didn't happen, did it? I feel very sorry for the guys that are going these days. Especially because some of them don't know, I'm sure, why they're fighting. In those days, we all knew why we were leaving home, and we weren't sure what it was, you know, we were so damn young. We weren't sure what it was going to mean.
And thank you so much, Bob. Oh, I appreciate it.
Well, I hope we found something you can use.
Oh, we sure we did.